Alright, so we are turning to a new part of the lecture about a different kind of learning algorithm, which are called decision trees. Decision trees form a different kind of hypothesis space that I would like to introduce now. It is a tree-based hypothesis space. We look at a setting again, just as you have seen before on various other slides, and the setting looks quite similar. Perhaps the biggest difference to previous versions of the classification problem that we are looking at is that we are not restricting very much the feature space. Although we do tend to look more at feature spaces which are composed of so-called nominal features. I will get into that in a minute. Otherwise, everything stays more or less the same. We have a set of classes C. We have an ideal classifier, small c, which maps the feature space to the set of classes. And since the ideal classifier is usually unknown, we have a lot of examples for which we know the class. And our goal now is to try and approximate this classifier using the examples and the decision tree learning algorithm. Let us start with a basic example. You will recall this example from earlier in the lecture. We used it also with the concept learning approach. To learning from a different kind of hypothesis space. Although it is not altogether alien to this one, one might say that decision trees generalize what is found in concept learning to a little bit more complex hypothesis. So the example stays the same. We are given basically descriptions of days, and we describe a day with six different features. What the sky looks like, what's the temperature like, or what does the temperature feel like? So we do not give the actual temperature. So we have here a nominal way of looking at temperature, not a quantitative way. We look at humidity, which is also not really quantified, but rather described. We look at wind, water, and what is the forecast for the day. And all of this together, for each of these examples, what the day might look like, we then have a decision for the target concept, enjoy sport, whether or not we will enjoy sport, doing sports on this day. So we have here now three examples, there can be more. And below the examples, you see what we would call now a decision tree. It's a tree where each node of the tree, which is not a leaf node, is assigned an attribute. For example, the root node of the tree is assigned the attribute sky. And each edge of the tree leading out from either the root node or an inner node then corresponds to the different values that the sky attribute or feature can take. So in our case, sky has the domain sunny, cloudy, and rainy. The sky could look sunny, the sky could look cloudy, the sky could look rainy. And then the decision tree continues basically recursively. With each further inner node, we look at a different feature of an example and then apply. If we look here at temperature, for example, two possible values, cold or warm. Then the only node type left are the leaf nodes that we see here, like all nodes which have no children. They do not have an attribute assigned to them, but a label from our target concept. We have a binary target concept. We can either say, yes, we enjoy sport, or no, we will not enjoy sport. And every leaf node is assigned one of those labels. What this tree can do for us now in this form is we can just take an example and then by traversing from the root to one of the leaf nodes, given or using the actual actual feature values that we see in the example, we can then decide what probably the example is like. Is it a yes example or is it a no example? So we could say we take, for example, now the first one here, and we look at the sky attribute and see that it's sunny. So we traverse this edge and land now at this inner node of the decision tree, where the node is associated with the temperature feature, which we also look up in our example, which is warm. We follow this edge and we arrive at the leaf node where the label, where the label says yes. So this decision tree is consistent with the first example. Also, if the first example were one that we have not seen before for some reason, so if this were a test example or something like that, we would say that this example has been decided correctly by following this procedure. Looking at this a little bit more abstractly, we say that a decision tree partitions the feature space. So for example, if we look at the root node of the decision tree, which is associated with the feature sky, then on each edge emanating from the root node, a different part of the feature space is considered. So if we follow the leftmost edge, which is labeled sunny, then we will only look at examples from the feature space where the sky attribute has the value sunny. And this is basically what's written here. So we look at the subset of examples from our feature space, which when projected to the sky attribute, we find the value sunny. And the same, similar, for the cloudy attribute and the rainy attribute. Together, joined again, these three subsets make up the entire feature space. So what I've explained now is basically a very rough and quick way of explaining what a decision tree does. And we are now most interested in learning how can we construct decision trees? What is the way of, what is the performance or the effectiveness of decision trees when we learn? And what are the decisions that we have to make in order to construct a decision tree or in order to choose a decision tree? Because there can be many different decision trees, which is suitable for our learning task. So for example, here we only consider the three attributes sky, temperature, and wind, but ignore humidity, water, and forecast. They do not have any bearing on deciding examples when we use this decision tree. So how do we decide which features or attributes we leave out? In order to get to the bottom of this, we need to take a little bit of a round trip and look at what this partitioning actually does. So this is what we also call splitting. I will get to this on the next slide. And then define more rigorously what a decision tree actually is or does. So first definition, a splitting. We have a feature space X. And we have a set of examples from this feature space, which we call D, as we know from our setting. And the splitting of X of the feature space is then a partitioning into subsets, X1 through XS, for example, S different subsets. And this partitioning must have the property that when we combine all the subsets again, we get the original feature space X. None of the partitions, none of the splits is empty, and the splits are mutually exclusive, which means that no example will end up in two different splits at the same time. So they are not overlapping. If we partition or split the feature space into these subsets, automatically we also organize the examples into a similar partitioning. Here, it may very well be that our example set does not cover certain examples from one of these splits, so that we do not require the individual example subsets to be non-empty. However, they are also mutually exclusive. In what circumstances can we apply such partitionings? Or how can we apply them given different kinds of features? So in the most general case, we have a representation of any value from our feature space. Let it be like in our example here, a day with certain properties, or it can also be anything else or in any other example that we're looking at, just some features that are aligned, that are organized as a vector here, and every feature value can then have a very specific value, x1, x2, x3, given this example or what the example is like. We know that every feature, for example, x3, can have different, comes from a domain, every feature value, and this domain may have a number of discrete values here, a1 through am, but it may also be a continuous value or something else. And what we have implicitly done here before, perhaps a notation you have not necessarily seen before, is that we use the projection operator here in order to look only at this feature of the feature vector. So this terminology just says that from the feature vector X, we look only at the attribute A to obtain just the value given to that attribute. This is basically a projection onto this single dimension of the feature vector. Now, if we want to split a given feature space, we have to look very closely at what kinds of features we have. And this pertains to the measurement scale. I will show you. This is a different part of the lecture or a different lecture altogether where this, can be found. It is in the data mining course, and you can click on the link and you will find this slide also. So I will not go into very much detail here, but just so that you have seen this and so that you understand the specific difference between looking at attributes or features which are categorical or which qualitatively describe an example. For example, if we say temperature is warm or cold, then this is a qualitative description, something that we feel or something that we judge fuzzy when we say 15 degrees is warm or 15 degrees Celsius is cold. But as I just said, we could also say measure temperature in a numeric form. We could say temperature in Celsius, and then we would have a quantitative way of looking at a feature. Both is fine in the end, and it depends very much on what you want to learn and how difficult the learning problem is, what you need or what is required. So if you remember the regularization part, deliberately choosing a less fine-grained feature space with only nominal features, for example, where we can only assign names to certain specific values, where the values are basically only names where we can say they are the same or they are different, but we cannot really compare them otherwise, compared to saying, for example, we measure temperature in Celsius, which is much more fine-grained, gives us more inductive bias. So which means the less fine-grained our feature space, the more inductive bias. So we have to really also make up our minds how to describe these variables. And as you can see here, so we could describe temperatures with just warm or cold, could say this is nominal, although there is perhaps an ordering also between warm and cold, because warm seems to be bigger than cold. So we could also consider this ordinal to some extent, or as you also see here, so quality, good, better, best, something like this. And if we look at the numeric side of things and quantifying things, then we can have an interval scale, which is would be, for example, temperature in Celsius, where we can, where addition and subtraction make sense. Although if we take a different scale, the Kelvin scale, then also ratios of temperatures make sense. So it gives us more fine-grained information. This is just a quick recap of the different kinds of measurements that we can take. So going back, dependent on what kinds of features we have, and we are at the moment mostly looking at nominal features, the splitting may look like this. So when we look at a decision tree like this one, we split at every inner node regarding one of the features, in this case sky, and this is a nominal feature. We have sunny and rainy and cloudy. And here we have the formal version of this splitting, where we can say we have a feature attribute A, and this has m different possible values that we can just enumerate. That means the splitting is then just the projection, the subsets where in each subset we project to one specific feature value, A1 through AM. And all of this combined gives us the original feature space X, and the properties that we require here are fulfilled. If we want to be even more abstract, we could say we do not want to split a nominal feature in all possible ways that the feature values allow, but also maybe just split in a binary way. And here we could simply say that all that we form subsets of the possible attribute values. For example, we could take A1 as one subset and the remainder as another subset, and then split in two subsets here, projecting either to A1 and to the rest of the features, and requiring that in the first subset, the feature value is part of this subset, A prime. And in the remainder subset, the feature value is not part of this subset. So this would give us a binary split using a nominal feature. Looking at ordinal features, so features that can be ordered, that have an internal ordering, or even this could even be extended then to ratio features or interval features as well. We can also use the ordering criterion. We can define a certain value from the domain and say that we have binary splitting for all examples whose feature value for that attribute is greater than or equal this value, and the opposite subset where this feature value is smaller. So you can see here that we have different choices of how to build such splittings, and This, of course, immediately generalizes a little bit what we can do here. So even if we don't have this very nominal-only situation as in this example, but we measure temperature actually as degrees in Celsius, we could have also here in this attribute some kind of smaller than 50 degrees, more than 50 degrees, and still be happy with that. The learning algorithms can be extended to this, although in what follows we will mostly consider the case of nominal features like here. Yes. So given the definition of what is a splitting of the feature space, we can now define what is a decision tree. Again, we are given the feature space X, and we are given the set of classes that we want to, that the feature space X can be mapped to. And the decision tree we call uppercase T here for X and C is what is a finite tree. So it has a finite number of nodes, and it is a rooted tree. Say we have a distinguished root node, one node that we consider the root of the tree. Every non-leaf node or inner node T has three properties assigned. First, it is assigned a subset of the feature space, which we denote here as X of T, predicate X of T. And this subset of the feature space is basically It is assigned a subset of the feature space. And at the same time, this subset is splitted again. So there's a splitting for this subset, which corresponds to a selected attribute of the feature space. And third, we have a one-to-one mapping of each split of this subset to the child nodes, the successors of the given node, of the non-leaf node. We can look at this again here. For example, if we take this node with attribute temperature, we have here the subset of the feature space belonging to all examples where the temperature, where the sky is sunny. So this is our subset here, 1 and 2. And this is then, this subset of the examples or feature space is then divided again into all examples where the temperature is cold and all examples where the temperature is warm. Here we just have warm in our example set, but in the feature space there might be other examples where temperature is cold. Don't confuse this with here the third example, which does not belong into this branch of the tree. It belongs rather into this branch of the tree. But here, we do not look at the temperature. We just look at the wind. So even if here the feature temperature is cold, it has no bearing on this part of the tree. It only has bearing on this part of the tree, because the sky attribute is rainy. So if the node that we are looking at happens to be the root node, then and only then the subset of the feature space equates the feature space itself. So only at the root node, we have the entire feature space. At every inner node, we have always a subset of the feature space. And finally, as also explained before, at every leaf node, we have a class assigned. So I've said it before in without referring to a slide. Here it is written down again. And in order to now take an example and Given a decision tree, find a decision for that example. We basically execute three steps. We go to the root node of the tree. We look whether the root node is a non-leaf node. And if it is a non-leaf node, we find among its successors or children that node, T prime, whose subset, which is basically the splitting of XT, contains the example as per the attribute to which we are projecting using this node. And this step is repeated over and over again until this test does not work anymore and we are actually at the leaf node. And then the decision for that example is basically the respective class. So looking at this again, so if we take the first example, we first look at, we start at the root, we look at sky, sky is sunny, like here, so we follow this edge, and then we look at temperature, temperature is warm, so we arrive at the leaf node, and the label is yes. The hypothesis space, so the possible hypothesis that can be learned is basically the set of all possible decision trees that can be formed according to this definition. And with respect to our feature space X and the classes that we're looking at. And we are searching for a decision tree that not only classifies our examples properly that we are given as learning examples, so our training examples, but that then also will classify correctly any other example that we might get in the future, an unseen example, for example, for testing. Perhaps as a small addition also, we could look at every path in the decision tree as basically a rule, an if-then rule. If the sky is rainy and the wind is light, then enjoy sport, yes. We could also look at it basically by just looking at the this clause here as a logical formula. If our example fulfills this formula, then enjoy sport, yes. So if we took from our example decision tree all paths that lead to a label yes, just the paths that lead to a label yes, and put them in a logical formula which says sunny and warm, or cloudy or rainy and yet light for the different attributes, sky, temperature, and wind, then every example that we might have here might be decided as well by just checking whether this logical formula is true. Let me go back. Not sure where we were. I think it was here. Okay, so we have implicitly used this notation here of X of T, this predicate, and here it is again defined formally, where we say X of T denotes a subset of the feature space that is represented by the node T, the decision tree node T, and D of T denotes a subset of the example set D that is represented by T as well, simply because any partition or splitting of the feature space so that that gives us this subset also induces the same subset in our example set, where it is defined as all examples from the example set for which the example belongs to this subset. So you can also look it up again here in the definitions. For illustration, we see here a generic decision tree with three layers, and we have some node T1 to which basically the entire feature space as well as the entire example set is assigned because it is the root node of the decision tree. So we have here the entire example set D of T1. And for some attribute and its binary values or binary splitting of the attributes of the feature assigned to this node, we have then two subsets of the example set and as well as the feature space. And here it is basically this subset belonging to this node and this subset belonging to that node, making up together the entire set of examples. Then here, for example, succeeding node T2, we have nodes T4 and T5 in the next layer of the decision tree, where T4 is a leaf node, which is assigned a class label here, denoted by a color, or also here as C3, the third class of our set of classes C. And this then gives here, which is not written here, but this then gives D of T4, basically a subset of the examples for which we can make an easy decision just by looking at two different attributes, because all examples here apparently are from the same class, as indicated by the colors. Similarly, for the next decision, next child of T2, which is T5, and here another splitting takes place of that subset that belongs to T5, and here we see that we can split it in two further splits, which are also perfectly decided, dependent on two assignments of class. So either, for example, here the green class, C3, can be decided with examples following this edge, or we follow this edge and lead to the which leads to the same class. The yellow class C1 here can also be found via two paths in the decision tree, T1, T2, T5, or T1, T3, and then T6. We have a third class C2, and that class can also be decided here. The notation is, we have omitted it, but it's clear that there also here comes a T7 and so on and so on. Just not to clutter up the graphics illustration too much. And here we have, this is the only case where we have this third class. And then we have a special situation here where examples from two different classes end up in the same leaf node. And here it is actually not clear which class, not pretty clear which class to assign. And this is then where we need to actually make decisions when or we need to make judgments calls when constructing a decision tree. Should we now further subdivide this set, this split of the example set, in order to be able to distinguish between the examples that belong to the class C3 and the examples that belong to the class C1? Or are we content with this? Or can we even do this? Because it might just very well be that the examples that we have here are contradictory, so that they are not distinguishable by any other attribute, that we have no choice but to putting them together and then making a call and say, these are all C1s. Perhaps another small notation thing that we will use, you know that in our setting we have the classifier C, which maps from X to C, and we usually want to learn a model function Y, in this regard either depending on a node or depending on the entire tree that maps the feature space X to the classes. And for ease of legibility, we just replace these symbols that we should have usually written by these symbols. So we consider every node as well as the entire tree a classifier or a model of a classifier. Perhaps also quite interesting here, as Benno said also in the previous lecture, with the decision tree, we can have non-linear decision boundaries in a feature space, which means that the example that he showed before could also be solved with the decision tree. So the example that was difficult for the perceptron alone, which could only be solved with the multilayer perceptron, it could also be solved using decision tree. Although the decision boundary would cut through the feature space in a different way. So how can we construct a decision tree? And here we give you basically a template of a construction algorithm. The specific construction algorithms that we are looking at maybe in the next lecture, for example, the ID3 algorithm, they can be abstracted to follow, or they can be shown to basically follow this template, although they do certain things or small things differently. In general, the construction of a decision tree follows five steps. As an input, we get a set of examples first. And because the construction algorithm is recursive, we also, so it calls itself, we also can take as an input a subset of examples, which would then be a splitting of the feature space and by extension also of the examples. And the output is either with, when we call it the first time, the root node of the decision tree, or when we have a recursive call, like here, then we get basically the root node of a subtree of the decision tree. In the first step, we basically simply create a new node. And to every node of the decision tree, we assign a class label. And we use a function for that, which is called representative class. You might think of this as, so the most basic way to decide which class to use, for example, if we look at the illustration here again, and in this particular case, where we have to make a decision which class to assign to this node, we might just choose the class for which we have most examples in this subset of the example set. And since apparently there are more examples belonging to class one than belonging to class three, we can just assign class one. However, and this is why we do not just say take the majority class, there can be a different reasoning what the class should be. And this is why we just use a generic function here called representative class. And I hope we get there today. Yes, I think we might still make it. I can show you how this is selected. Second step, we decide, given the input of the set of examples or subset of examples, whether it is impure. Impurity means basically that there's more than one, that there are examples in the subset which have more than one class. Not an individual example has more than one class, but we have many examples and we have examples from two or more different classes. And this is a basic way of saying there's impurity here or not. However, again, this is not the simple rule that we usually apply. We will make a more complex decision because, as also seen here in the illustration, maybe we do not want to further subdivide once we have reached a certain depth of the decision tree, and then this will stay as it is. And here the impure function should perhaps say this is not impure enough so that a further subdivision is necessary. If the set of examples that we are looking at is sufficiently impure, then we decide on a split criterion, which then relates to our definition of splitting and the way we can split. So we decide which attribute to use, and we decide how to split by that attribute, dependent on which measurement scale we have. And we then use this criterion in the third step to actually split the example set into its subclasses as per the splitting of the feature space and use the decompose function for that. And if it is not impure enough in the second step, then we just return the node as is. We have previously assigned a label to that node, so the node will serve as a leaf node. Otherwise, we obtain the splitting again using the criterion we have decided, and then for each of the subsets, we construct a child node using a recursive call of this function, using just this subset, each one in turn, and then at the node of the root node of the subtree constructed by this recursive call to this node. And in the end, we return the node that we have constructed, which might be the root node of a subtree, a leaf, or the root node of the entire decision tree. Here's the algorithm or the algorithm version of how we use decision trees to classify an example. So I will not go into this much deeper, because here in the previous slide you see how it is the written down version, although there's also a slight difference here. Here we have basically an iterative version of this algorithm, and here we have also a recursive version of this algorithm.
Martin, quick interruption. There is a question in chat already from 2 minutes ago. Does this representative class include all attributes of space? We might need some clarification. I personally don't quite understand the question.
Me neither, actually. So the representative class is the class of the examples. Let us look back. Let us look back at the introductory example. So this column here, enjoys board, is our target concept, and this is the class that we want to assign, either yes or no. So every time a node is constructed here, while we construct this tree, we have to decide which class to assign. So for example, also this node will get a class label assigned, although we do not see it here, using the construction algorithm. And this class, for example, may be here yes if we have more examples which have a yes label, or no if we have more examples with a no label. So we might choose the majority class, although this is not necessarily what we want to do. It depends. If we have the 50-50 case, we might select randomly.
Martin, I would also give just a note on this question. Is this okay?
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
If you look at this tree where you are and pick a certain node from this tree, then you have a path from the root to this node where you look on. And the decision in the node where you look on depends only on the attributes that you have seen while going from the root to this node. And in this sense, you can say somehow this classification, this class at this node, considers only the attributes seen so far. I say it a bit with hesitating, because the class is independent of the idea of attributes, like you pointed out, Martin. But when you go at a certain node, the classification decision depends only on the attributes you have seen. And that means also the class itself at this node is only characterized by these attributes which you have seen in this point. Yeah. As this, in that sense, the student is right. Yeah.
Yeah, so we are looking at a certain subset of the feature space where we say in advance, for example, that the sky is sunny. And in this sense, yes, we want to only find the representative class which belongs to cases, to examples where we have the prior information that the sky attribute of all these examples is sunny.
Yeah. And also to give a longer answer, this, yes, exactly this is it. We do not know the truth. Perhaps the class has completely different attributes and much more than you have modeled here. But we see the class only through the glasses of our attributes, and the decision tree sees the class only to the glasses of the attributes which the decision tree algorithm has seen up to this point.
Yeah.
Where it does this decision.
Okay.
It means that the class on the higher level has fewer features in that sense to be distinguished than the class on a lower level. Okay, but don't make it too complicated now.
Yeah, no worries. Thank you. Okay, so as I said, the classification algorithm is also here implemented as a recursive algorithm. We get this input feature vector X and either the root node or some inner node of a decision tree. And the output would then be our class prediction, which here is Y of X. So we first check, is the node a leaf node? Then we can just return the label. Otherwise, we just return the recursive call using that child of the node T, to which the example in question belongs as per the feature attribute that is actually set in this example. So again, look here, just to clarify this, we take the first example. This is our node we are currently looking at. We look at the feature sky. We see it is sunny, so we traverse the edge sunny, and we arrive at this node. This would then be the input to the recursive call, where we start again. Here, as I said, this is basically the same in high language, although in an iterative sense, not in a recursive sense, which does not make much of a difference, just a small remark. All these functions are here briefly explained again, so no worries if you haven't picked it up from what I said just now, just you can look it up here again. So this basically introduces decision trees conceptually. So means the basic concepts of how decision trees are constructed, how decision trees work, and how they are used for classification, you know them now. And decision trees lend themselves to certain problems which have a number of properties which we have seen also implicitly before. For example, if we can actually properly describe our objects with feature value combinations. So, and at the same time, if the target function, so the concept that we are looking at is a discrete. So unlike the regression case where we where we basically employ a method that is supposed to predict a continuous value with the model, here we can directly assume that we can just have just two classes, three classes or so. However, in the regression case, if you look at the examples that we have there for classification, we break down this continuous prediction of the regression function to a discrete labeling, to discrete class labeling. So since we are always looking in these parts of the lectures at classification problems, I guess also the previous problems that we have apply could be solved by decision trees or could be attacked by the decision trees at least. For example, decision trees lend themselves to situations particularly where we where we can suspect or where we actually know that formulating rules or formulating logical formulas in disjunctive normal form, here's the Wikipedia article linked, so let's discard the not. We didn't talk about not for this form A and B or C, could actually be used to solve many problems. And decision trees are robust to noise in the training data, which might include contradictions. So having examples which have basically the same attributes with the features that we look at in the decision tree. And here I can go back to our illustration again, right here. We might have a situation here where we have label noise and we have examples where all these three feature values for the examples are the same both in both cases, although different labels have been attached because different persons have attached the labels and they have not been in agreement. This happens often enough when we assign labels manually to examples, even sometimes when we do so automatically and do not pay attention. You might have noticed even when you worked on the genre classification labeling at the beginning of the lecture, where probably this has also happened to you. And there's a different kind of noise that could happen, namely that we have missing attribute values. So for example, it might very well be that we have examples where we do not know what the temperature was on that day. We could still use a decision tree then, although we would be left, if we look at the beginning example again, we would be left on sunny days with a way of not knowing what to do here. And this is why also this node gets assigned a label. We could just then use the label that which has been assigned to this node, which, as I said, for example, might just be the majority vote here. Yes, certain in the past, also today, a number of application areas where decision trees have been successfully applied, especially in medical diagnosis, fault detection and technical systems, and we also had already the example of risk analysis for credit approval, and a number of further ones could be looked at. As I said, we now know all the important concepts by which decision trees get constructed, and now comes basically the difficult part, where we have to decide or answer the questions of how to make these decisions that I've been talking about before. Not only how can examples be efficiently and effectively exploited, but more specifically, at what point should we decide for a new node in the construction to become a leaf node? So this refers to the impurity decision. Or how should we assign a class label now specifically? This refers to this representative class function. And finally, how can we say if a decision tree is working well or not well? So since we are running out of time, I see in the I see a notification there. I will leave it for today